we have to understand that every rule that gets written has a cost. I don't think parents get that under the headline, we're going to keep your children safe, we're going to protect the kids, that's really code for we're taking your rights away.
Hi, I'm Nick Gillespie with Reason TV, and today we are talking with Abby Schachter. She is a longtime journalist and the author of the fabulous new book, No Child Left Alone, Getting the Government Out of Parenting. Abby, thanks for talking to us.
It's great to be here.
The book is all about how government at all levels and other kind of Budinsky groups are getting more and more involved in the raising of children, of child rearing. Give some of the most exemplary illustrations of just how annoying and frustrating this is. And why don't you start with your daycare experience that you start the book with?
Right. So I didn't set out to be a radical. I just wanted my kids swaddled at daycare. But that isn't okay with the state of Pennsylvania. And it's where I drew the line and got into this subject. We have four children. They've all gone to state licensed daycare. There were a huge number of rules and regulations that were annoying, but we lived with them.
Right.
And then the fourth one was born, and we brought him to daycare at 9 weeks of age. And they said, what do you want us to know about him? And I said, one thing, please swaddle him tightly.
And that means wrapping the baby in
wrapping
a kind of blanket so that they
sleep like baby
easier.
Jesus,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's been done for thousands of years. It was the only parenting book we actually read and followed. Dr. Harvey Karp, I'm a big proselytizer for him, happiest baby on the block. All our children sleep because of swaddling. So that was it, that's all I wanted. And the daycare said we need a doctor's note because the state of Pennsylvania otherwise bans swaddling in daycare. So I said, that is crazy. I've never heard of such a thing. And
they pushed you too far.
They pushed me too far.
Yeah.
I just said, that is it. And I said, I'm donning my cape. I am now a captain mommy, I'm taking charge. And I thought, oh, okay, I'll just get the doctor's note. I actually started off thinking this will be a reasonably easy thing to get done. And it turns out it's not, because some of the same people who are pushing this kind of overly broad definitions of safety and lack of acceptance of risk are the people who the doctors, pediatricians, go to get opinions for how they should advise their patients.
So that is, I mean, one clear case of government regulation or of you know, some kind of authority coming in and saying, no, you've got to do it this way in this circumstance. What are a couple of others?
So the worst example are the dozens of cases of the state coming and taking custody of children who are morbidly obese.
Mm-hmm.
These are heartbreaking stories. The family tends to be unhealthy, not just the child, and they are really unhealthy. But the state says that the best they can do is remove a child from its family, causing other damage, but they're gonna try and solve, in quotes, this one problem.
And that's the super fat kid.
That's the super
does
fat
it,
kid.
Does it work? Is it effective at least?
Well, it depends who you talk to. There are lots of doctors who say just force them to have surgery. I mean, bariatric surgery, a teenager could live a much longer life than trying to change behavior. Behavior modification is actually very difficult to achieve successfully,
right,
and yet the state is basically saying that's what we're going to do.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, that's hard for individuals, you know, who are really dedicated to it, but then to get a bureaucrat to do it, to make somebody else pay attention. You also talk about the war on fun and the kind of play deficit.
Right, so there are all kinds of experts who will talk about, Peter Gray talks about this a lot, you know, the deficit of unsupervised, imaginative, free play amongst kids. Some of that is parents. They don't want to let the kids out of the house, or they overschedule them. Okay, but if you don't have recess at school, which a lot of parents are fighting for, if you ban certain activities, sledding in a public playground, running in a public space, pushing other kids on the swing. So all kinds of activities end up being banned, not because the government comes along or the school system comes along and says, hey, we don't want these kids to have any fun, but they are defining a problem and they are solving it in their easiest sort of overly broad way, which is we're just going to ban it.
So why is this kind of stuff happening now? I've been writing about the different experience of childhood, right. You know, from my childhood to my kids' childhood. For 20 years, my kids are now 22 and 14, and in the 90s when I started thinking about this stuff, I realized, wow, their lives are so different than the one I grew up in, and mine was, you know, on another planet from my parents. So why is this kind of structure happening? Is it simply that in two-income households, both parents are away and you put your kids into institutionalized settings more? Is it, ridiculous overestimations of risk? What's going on here?
I think that it's a combination of things. I think there has been several media hysterias having to do with children, right? Abduction was one, and this is a mythology that has so taken root that we have had low crime rates for 15 years, and I still get people reacting to my book saying, but the kid could get abducted, you know?
Why does that linger so long, and how does it continue to inform policy and kind of mental maps?
Well, because we moved from abductions, let's say, to the hysteria over Satanism at daycare, right? That was the 90s.
I would have paid extra if I could have gotten my kid into the Satanist daycare.
And at least if I could have done that now, it would have been cheaper.
Yeah, they would have been swaddling, I'm sure. I'm pretty sure.
The Satanists would swaddle. That would have been a reason to try it out.
Yeah.
I think that it's all of these hysterias that have taken hold, and anxiety is really hard to combat. Yeah. I mean, I think that's a large part of this.
You also talk about, you reference Philip K. Howard, the author whose best known book is The Death of Common Sense. And he talks a lot about how people, oftentimes in a good natured way or in a good faith way, say, look, this is just common sense, let's put a law in or a process. And then it goes in a very different direction. Is that a contributing factor
Absolutely.
Here, the kind of over-lawyering of everyday life?
Well, the over-lawyering, I mean, look, part of it is practical. The trial lawyers get work, mm-hmm. right? If you can sue, and we don't have a reform as simple as loser pays, then you have an incentive to sue the municipality if your kid gets hurt sledding. Mm-hmm. And these municipalities are struggling to pay their pensions, so they don't want to fight a lawsuit. Mm-hmm. They'll settle, and then they'll just ban the activity. So some of these critiques, and in Howard's case, he's absolutely right also about the nature of the regulation. We don't say our value is X, and therefore we want to allow people to achieve that value, whether it be safety or reducing risk. You find a way to do it, mm-hmm. right? What we say is you have to have the hooks in daycare this far apart because that's the safety standard,
right?
So we're not being
led by general principles or goals. It's rather
exactly.
being very kind of literal and specific.
Absolutely, yeah. And you see that everywhere, and you see that with sort of the Consumer Product Safety Commission, their labels. Right? There's no common sense in their warning labels, because what do they put on the warning labels for baby seats? Don't put this on a high surface where the baby might fall. I mean, you would think mm-hmm. this is common sense, right? Instead, they hounded the manufacturer of the Bumbo, and now they changed the name of the product. So now it's called the Bumbo Floor Seat, right? As if it was too difficult for people to understand that it was not meant to be put up on a table or a chair. It was meant to sit on the floor, and that would be the safest place for a baby.
Here's a challenge. Is it possible, you know, we know from looking at the results of school tests for K through 12 students, going back to the early 70s when they started doing this, the kids aren't getting any smarter. Maybe parents aren't as smart as they once were.
That's also possible. I mean, I wouldn't put it, but I would say that I have found some very smart parents writing mm-hmm. this book. No Child Left Alone, I tried to enter as many examples of parents who, like myself, just said, this is the stupidest thing I've ever heard of in my life, and I want to be left alone to parent my own kid.
And talk a bit about, what is the cure? Where do we go from here? Because you're against the idea that there is a kind of big switch where we can go from insanity to sanity.
Right.
What are the types of activities, what are the types of things that can happen to kind of free our children, and by extension, free us as parents to you know, kind of live in a world that is more interesting and exciting and ultimately better for both parents and children?
So the two things I would suggest are, one, bring the problem solving closer to the supposed problem. I had to go and find the people who made up this rule about swaddling, right. And they weren't in my state, and they weren't even accountable. They couldn't. I couldn't yell at them because it wasn't their fault. They wrote a nice book of guidelines. And the other thing I would say is that we have to understand that every rule that gets written has a cost. I don't think parents get that under the headline, we're going to keep your children safe, we're going to protect the kids, that's really code for we're taking your rights away.
Would you draw a connection between the way that we treat our children when they're kind of in, you know, K through 12 or when they're living at home with us? Would you trace a line from that and kind of the infantilization of kids in a way that is more than it used to be, and parents, because parents aren't allowed to make choices? Is that part of what we're seeing on college campuses when we see either administrators or even students themselves demanding a kind of more infantile safe space in college campuses?
I mean, it's hard for me to say that it's a direct line, mm-hmm. but certainly there's an influence, because what you're hearing about what happens to college kids is they get there and they don't know how to live mm-hmm. in a world that isn't a safe space.
Right.
So they're demanding it because that's what they've experienced. If you're also coming from a place where you never rode the city bus mm-hmm. anywhere, you never got anywhere on your own, or your time was all managed by somebody else, you really aren't going to have that many skills, and you really are going to think, who would have in your life come to you and said, no, you actually have to do this for yourself now, mm-hmm. because some parents haven't been doing that, and certainly your teachers haven't been saying that, and and the government is not saying that. They've been saying the opposite.
Well, we will leave it there. We have been talking with Abby Schachter. She is the author of the excellent book, No Child Left Alone, Getting the Government Out of Parenting. Abby, thanks for talking to us.
Pleasure. Thank you.
For Reason TV, I'm Nick Gillespie.